Happy Sunday, kitten. It is, oh goodness, what day is it? It is December 18th, I believe, 2016, and this is Knot A Podcast episode 172. Welcome, and thank you so much for joining me today, both new and returning viewers. This is a podcast mostly about knitting and some spinning sometimes, cross-stitch, sewing, little bit about dyeing. It's just about whatever I happen to be working on at the time, but right now I'm focusing on knitting. And let's see, I am your host, Amanda. You can find me as Wit on Ravelry or as So Nitpicky on Instagram and on YouTube. Show notes for this episode and other Knot A Podcast episodes can be found on the blog at sonitpicky.net, where you can also find other blog entries. I still do blog once in a while, even though it is kind of a dying art form because Instagram has kind of replaced that. But I do a monthly yardage tally for how much I've worked, as well as quarterly stash down posts. So if you find that sort of thing interesting, you might want to head over there and read those. Let's see, there is a Knot A Podcast group on Ravelry. If you put in Knot, K-N-O-T, a podcast, it should come right up in the search results. And I am the dyer for Lammy Toes, which is lammytoeshop.etsy.com. I think I got through my intro today without too many stumbles, so go me. The last few have been kind of rough. Let's see, kittens. I don't think there's anything else in the introduction. I just want to make a note that Fall Into Shawls is wrapping up now. We are down to about just under 2 weeks left. It ends on December 31st. The rules are over in the rules and chatter thread in the Ravelry group. It's stickied at the top of the forums and really easy to find. If you would like to play if you would like to play along for prizes, you do need to be a member of the Ravelry group. But if you want to just come in and chat, there's no requirements whatsoever. But if you would like to play along and try to win prizes, yeah, I would like you to join, please. I think we have almost 300 members in the group now, and usually the group is relatively active, so that makes me pretty happy. I like seeing you all chat, and I like talking to you. Before we get started today, it's been almost 2 weeks since my last recording, where I did the really interesting tower in the middle of the evening, because we are quickly coming up on the shortest day of the year. It's not technically a short day as in a 24-hour period, but shortest amount of daylight in the Northern Hemisphere. On Wednesday, I think it'll be. Yeah, Wednesday is the winter solstice, which is when up here we have our shortest amount of daylight and our longest nighttime. And after that, the days will start to get longer again. So hopefully I will be able to start recording again at 2 or 3 in the afternoon and not have that weird evening light where it's actually, the sun's been down before 5 o'clock the last week or so. It's been extremely dark. So today it is actually about 1 o'clock in the afternoon, and I'm trying to hurry because my family would like to go see Rogue One at the theater on post. They're playing it this weekend, and they don't usually do opening weekend movies, but sometimes they do, and they call them first run movies because it's opening weekend. And yeah, we would like to try to go see that, but I have a suspicion that everyone else is going to be out too, and it might be a little bit too busy. So we'll see. Since I last talked to you guys, it's been very wintry, although in the last podcast I did treat you guys to video footage of that first real, actually the second real snow we've had. We had one earlier, but then the temperatures popped back up and we got unusually warm. Everything melted, and now it stayed pretty cold, including the polar vortex came over and flirted with us for a couple of days, then went away, and it's inching its way back over here. So tonight it's going to be unbelievably cold, sub-zero again, but it's fairly normal for this time of year, even if it's maybe a month early. Usually January and February is when we go sub-zero quite regularly, pretty much every day, and things get icy and kind of miserable here. So it might be just a little early, but it's not unreasonable towards the end of December. Let's see, my husband's been on vacation all week, so that was interesting having him home. It's been nice having someone else in the house with me who is not my dogs or not a sick child. Luckily, we've all been very healthy here. I'm gonna knock on wood. Oops. Lightly knock. And so yeah, it's been pretty good here. We have a couple more days before we head back to Wisconsin for a very quick trip. We had not planned to go this year, but because my grandmother's health is not doing so hot. This is probably the last opportunity I'm going to have to see her. So we are making a quick trip home. I will be spending most of my time with my family and with my grandmother. I'm going to try to insist on visiting every day if she will allow it. She has been quite difficult and stubborn lately. She doesn't want to see most people. She's been very reclusive. She hasn't left her home in over 2 months. She refuses to go out and do anything. She complains about being lonely, but doesn't really want anybody coming into the house to visit her. She has already told both my mother and my aunt that yes, she would like me to come visit, but for a lot of people, she's really not having it at the moment. So that's been a little sad, knowing that she's kind of closed herself up in her home, but that kind of happened more. It got worse. Sorry, I'm leaning forward here to grab my tea, guys. It got worse about, I would say, almost a month and a half ago. My grandmother was the oldest of four children. Her middle two siblings had passed away in longer ago. My grandmother has been very ill. She has, in case you haven't been around with me for 2 years here, she has stage 4 ovarian cancer. It had been treated with chemotherapy, and she had surgery to remove her ovaries and little bits that had started to travel to other organs on her body. And it very quickly grew back, and it's to the point where they stopped treating it because the treatment was going to kill her faster than the cancer. So she has been kind of just sitting around. I think we're on month 5 of the unofficial, we think you've got about 6 months left diagnosis. So she's been in her home. Hospice comes in and visits her. Anyway, we were talking about her siblings. Her youngest brother, who is, I think, 13 or 12 years younger than her, he had heart problems, which is what she always thought she would have problems with, because her family has a lot of that. And unfortunately, her younger brother passed away. I can't remember if it was late October or early November. And at that point, she's kind of had a very difficult time maintaining more positive moods. So unfortunately, she's been very reclusive and doesn't want to leave her house. She hasn't felt very hungry. She finally did get a haircut, though. Hospice sent somebody in to cut her hair, and apparently that has helped improve her mood a little bit. But yeah, she just, understandably, she's not feeling well, and she just doesn't want to go anywhere or do anything. She just kind of wants to be left alone and in the quiet of her home. So anyway, long story here, giving some backstory. We're going home, and my plan is to visit her every day, even if it's only for a short period, and just talk to her, bring her some treats, and just try to keep her company a little bit. Although I know she's not doing as many things as she used to keep herself occupied. She's mostly been sitting in her chair and watching TV, which I can't imagine is overly interesting. My grandmother was always a reader. She used to be a sewist. She used to do all of her own clothing because she is extremely short. In her prime, she was 4'10" or 4'11". She's considerably shorter than that now. I think she's about 4'8" is what she shrunk down to. She's about the exact same size as my 10-year-old right now. He might even be just a tiny bit taller than her at this point. But she used to do that. She used to love to do word puzzles, finding words. I can't remember what those are all of a sudden called. Word searches? Letters? I don't know. Whatever you call those. You know what I'm talking about. And I think she used to do the crossword and other things, but she's kind of more recently lost her interest in doing any of that stuff among everything else. So I'm not quite sure what I'm going to do with her yet. I know she likes to watch me knit and do crafting stuff and talk about what I'm crafting, so I'm planning to take several projects home with me and different ones so that she can have a look at them and see what I'm up to. So yeah, actually I'll talk about this really quick too, because you see me drinking here tea. Quite some time ago, I was contacted by Andy over at Plum Deluxe Teas in Portland. And I forgot to get back to him. My main email box is constantly full. I get probably at least 100 emails a day in it from various newsletters and all the random stuff, you know, that we all get. And I've been working to fight the junk in my mailbox. But I forgot about it. Didn't answer him back. I don't even remember how long ago it was when you first contacted me, Indy. I'm sorry. But anyway, more recently, he contacted me again just to touch base with me and extended his offer again. Apparently, one of you very kindly told him about me and the podcast and that I am a tea drinker. Thank you, whoever that was. I'm not sure who it was, but thank you. And he asked me if I wanted to pick out some samples to try. I've got the card here that he sent with the package. Organic, non-GMO, fair trade, hand-blended teas. It's on the back here. It says, handcrafted tea infused with love. Every Plum Deluxe tea is thoughtfully crafted in Oregon with only the freshest ingredients from around the world. Join our Tea of the Month Club and enjoy a delicious limited edition artisan tea every month for only $10 per month. So anyway, I picked out a bunch of samples of black tea because if I'm drinking tea during the day and up until about this point of the day, I tend to drink black tea and I get some caffeine out of that. And then in the evening, I switch to fruit and nut and kind of herbal teas. But he sent me three samples. The first one, which I've already tried, is the Gratitude Black Tea Blend, which is a strawberry Earl Grey representing gratitude, appreciation, and kindness. This one was very good. It smells amazing. The strawberry wasn't quite as strong as I would have liked in this, but you could still taste hints of it, and it was a very lovely tea. The one I haven't tried yet is Coconut Macaron Dessert Tea, and it says indulge in fresh, chic flavor, just relax. And this one has black tea, honeybush tea, rooibos tea, coconut pieces, almond essence, love, and gratitude. It looks very tasty. I didn't try this one yet today either because today I tried the third sample, which is a vanilla latte tea. It says the comfort food of tea lovers, a delightful balance of sweet and spice. And in it is black tea, honeybush tea, ground cardamom, vanilla essence, love, and gratitude. And that is what I'm drinking now. And this is in one of my mugs from Society 6. These are my favorite mugs. This is the 15-ounce larger size that you can get from them. And this one is a beautiful watercolor badger print. I don't think the artist's name is on here, but when I do the show notes, I'll try to link to her shop so you can see them. I am a badger girl. I was born and raised in Wisconsin, which is the badger state. I was raised in the Madison area, which is the Wisconsin Badgers for all the sports teams. And my Harry Potter house, my Hogwarts house, is Hufflepuff, although I have very strong Ravenclaw tendencies. Non-official quizzes have always placed me as a Ravenclaw, with Hufflepuff as a very close second. The official sorting said, no, you are a Hufflepuff, and I don't know how high I scored on the Ravenclaw, so I joke that I'm like a Huffleclaw. Anyway, badgers. I am a badger girl. So the tea is in here, and it smells lovely. It has a very slight sweet smell to it. I can't really smell the spice, but I have to admit too that because our heater is running now, dust is blowing through the system. And you guys know, if you watched long enough, I have severe allergies. So unfortunately, this time of the year is hard for me. I end up being very congested because of all the dust blowing around, even though I'm constantly cleaning. And yeah, so it's nice and warm right now. And it's a really nice blend. Like, you can just very lightly taste the cardamom in here, which I do like. I enjoy blends that have that in it. When I make myself rice pudding, I put that in there too because I enjoy that spice very much. And it's just got a very nice, light, delicate taste to it. I don't put anything in my tea. I don't do milk. I don't usually do sugar. I just drink it straight as is, and it's perfectly lovely this way. So, Andy, thank you once again for sending me the samples. I'm definitely going to be looking to, when I run out of some of my other black teas, maybe do some replacing through Plum. Alright guys, so we are almost 15 minutes in and I haven't even talked about crafting yet. I just have a lot on my mind and I don't do a lot of actual physical talking anymore, so I talk to you guys. So anyway, I have a couple finished objects to show you guys today, I think. Yes, I do. Two. I have some works in progress and then I have just one or two things I can show you that came in since the last time we talked. So let's get right on it, shall we? The first thing I finished is a project that you guys have all seen. My goal for this year was to knit 8 personal pairs of socks for myself. I have knit, I think, 2 pairs of adult socks for my husband this year, and this was pair 7 of 8 for myself. You have seen these before. These are in Regia 4-ply Classic in colorway 44, which is a darker medium gray, a slightly heathered one. And these are in Trailing Clouds BFL nylon sock. This is the 7525. It's a lighter fingering weight at about 465 yards to 100 grams. And this was in the Belinda colorway. These were the socks that I knit because I was inspired by Laura at the Corner of Knit and Tees socks. She had done some really beautiful, I think the colorway is called Spooky Town or Halloween Town. They were from Post Yarns. You know, they do their own house brand of self-striping. And I realized I had yarn that is kind of similar and decided I needed to knit myself some socks too that are kind of like hers. Belinda is beautiful rusts and oranges and bright turquoise. And they went together and played very nicely with this dark medium gray regia. As you can see, I knit from different ends of the cake. When I do 2-at-a-time socks, even when I'm doing self-striping, unless for some reason I feel a strong urge to have them match up, I just knit from different ends of the cake, which means the striping sequence goes the opposite direction on each sock. I don't think it's super noticeable. I mean, if you looked really closely, you might see it. But as you can see, interestingly enough, those blue stripes match up quite a bit on the leg, which I find kind of interesting. And both of them started with the dark brown and ended with the dark brown, which makes me happy. I did my usual sock construction here. I started off with a Turkish cast on. I'm always a toe-up sock knitter. My socks just fit me better that way. I don't have to do that because my feet aren't large enough that it's really an issue and I don't knit them tall enough to have to worry. But I like to do toe-up because it's easier to fit. I did, I think, 14 stitches with a Turkish cast on. I knit every round for 5 rounds. I increased every round for 5 rounds, up to 24 stitches per needle, and then every third round until I hit the full stitch count on these, which I think was 68 stitches. And then I ended the toe and through the body, and up until about the point that I got to put in the heel, I snuck in, or sneaked in, I guess is more grammatically appropriate, 2 more stitches in the bottom to give me just a little bit more wiggle room around the heel as I did the Fish Lips Kiss heel, which this is my favorite heel. It's just absolutely beautiful. It looks and acts like a commercial heel, and I love how it fits. It's the best heel for me out of all the ones I've tried so far. But I like to sneak in a few extra stitches because although my feet are almost flat, I have very low arches and therefore need a lot of support in my shoes. I have a very wide instep, which I usually when your feet are flat, you're not supposed to have that wider instep, but I still have a really wide instep there. So I put in a couple extra there. And then as I got up the leg, as I got closer to the top here, even though I didn't make these very tall, I did sneak in an additional 2 stitches, I think. I'm looking real quick here. Yes, 2 more stitches in order to give me an even number for 2x2 ribbing at the top. I then did that for, I think I did 15 rounds on this one. I haven't tidied this up yet because I haven't woven the ends. And then I did Jenny's Surprisingly Stretchy Bind Off, which is my standard bind off. And as you see, it doesn't flute out for me, but I also keep my tension really nice and tight while I'm doing it. And it's perfectly stretchy. So these socks go just a couple inches over my ankle, which is normal for me. I usually don't go too much taller than about here. If I'm going to do a taller sock, I'll do that. But I wanted to maintain the thickness of the stripes. And because I took so long to work on these, I wasn't really in the mood to keep them on the needles an additional 1 to 2 days in order to get that extra inch or so of leg before I did the ribbing. I also didn't know if I was going to have to increase again in order to do that. And I just decided to call it off when I could because they're plenty long this way for me. So those are finally done. I'm not going to have time to do an 8th pair of socks for myself, but I'm going to say that 7 out of 8 wanted is a pretty good amount of socks, especially since I can wear them all the time up here, and I will. I'm still replacing some of my less properly fitting socks. Actually, I'm wearing one of those pairs today that I realized that I think this is going to be the last wearing, because if I weave in some ends on some new socks, I will be able to replace this current pair with at least 3 or 4 new ones. I'm going to call that good enough. My last pair of socks for the year is actually going to be another hand-spun pair for my husband, which is going to make three pairs this year for him. But I also want to be able to spin him some more sock yarn. And the easiest way to justify that is to use that up. And plus, for whatever reason, despite the fact that he has these massive feet, his socks just go more quickly. And I think that's because the yarns I use on those are often heavy sport to light DK weight. So they're... even though they're still a higher stitch count like my socks, they're in a thicker yarn, and they, because you know they're taller stitches, they go a lot more quickly despite having to knit several inches longer in all the dimensions. Now, my second finished object is one that you've seen if you follow me on Instagram, but you have not seen on the podcast because it was a very quick last minute decision to knit a gift for my daughter. This came out of a very old Knit Simple magazine. I think this is the only Knit Simple that I own because I'm not big on this magazine. Usually it's projects I don't really like to knit, but this is from fall 2011. And I had bought this magazine for one reason and one reason only. There is a pattern in it, several patterns actually, but one in particular from Rebecca Danger that I have wanted to knit for forever. I love Rebecca Danger's patterns. They're very simple. They're a very easy introduction to toy knitting if you want to knit toys and you want something that's cute but not super complicated. She has you knit it in pieces and attach and seam them on as you go. I actually converted this pattern to be almost completely seamless. I picked up all the stitches and did things that way, which means I had a lot less finishing work to do, but it did make things a little bit more tricky. Anyway, the one pattern that I bought this for is called Harriet the Haberdashery Hippo. Normally her toys are all knit in like worsted weight, but I am a fan of doing fingering weight toys. Also, by the way, this pattern can be bought for $6 on Ravelry by itself now. You no longer need this magazine, although there is one other sweater in here I kind of like, but I would have to edit it heavily to make it work because who needs super bulky weight baubles? Anyway, so I decided to do a fingering weight toy for my daughter, who this year is obsessed with the song, I Want a Hippopotamus for Christmas. I had not heard the song until recently, despite the fact that this is a really old song. Somehow I managed to get to be about 30 some years old and had never heard this song. Anyway, she's obsessed with it and sings it every day now. And I thought, and I remembered the pattern, and I thought, oh, you know, it would be kind of funny to give her a little hippopotamus for Christmas. So I pulled out one of my skeins of Knit Picks Felici. This is in the Jelly Bean colorway. I'm not as big of a fan for Felici for socks because I find it, even at a tight gauge, is very pilly and doesn't seem to make the most hard-wearing socks, but it makes adorable toys, very soft ones. So here is Harriet. She is tiny. She is super cute. And she took me about three nights of really intensive knitting and part of a day to get done. Fingering weight toys are very labor intensive for the amount of yardage out you get for them, but they're very satisfying. Harriet here took about 17 grams of sock yarn, meaning you could get two of these out of a single skein of Felici and still have enough left over to put into, say, like a sock yarn blanket. But overall, I'm really happy. I attached all the parts and did all the embroidery before I stuffed her. And if I were to do this again, because I didn't realize quite how far these parts were going to pull down as I seamed, I would have shifted the tail up a couple of rows as well as the belly button because they're kind of stuck at the bottom here. But still very, very cute. She is knit from the bottom up. Most Rebecca Danger patterns, this isn't really giving away the secret sauce, guys, because all of her patterns have the same structure. She likes to have you do the legs first, connect them around into the round, knit the head, and then knit all the little parts. So I ended up picking up all the stitches, like here at the ears. I picked these up off the head, figured out roughly what was the same on both sides, picked them up, finished them that way, and I like to secure in my ends as I go. I often will do a combination of weaving in a couple stitches plus tying larger knots that make it harder to pop the end out, as well as once I have lots of knots or lots of ends on the inside, I will actually tie the individual ends together to help secure them just a little bit more so that as the stuffing goes in, they all get kind of buried in the stuffing and hopefully they never ever come out. It helps to keep them secured down, I think, to not have the to not seam them on. It's just a preference. There was waste yarn, like a forethought heel used for the mouth here, and the stitches get picked up after. The only messy part about this was trying to get these two stitches into each corner. I wish I could have gotten that just a little bit neater and a little bit less. I think I should have probably twisted those two particular stitches. That would have helped. And then I put in the embroidery and the eyes before I finished up, but also, you know, I had to pick up the arms. I got those almost symmetrical this time. I think I'm one stitch farther forward on one side than the other. And then the tail's the only part that I couldn't figure out how to do seamlessly from the body. So I did that because it's an eye cord. I did that way and then attached it down. And instead of whip stitching things down, which patterns often tell you to do with toys, I actually mattress stitch everything on these. It's a little putzier, I guess, and it's not quite as quick, but it gives a really nice detail where it looks like the knitting is coming in. And actually you can see like in between the legs here where I seamed it together, I used this blue yarn seam and you can just barely see it poking out where I mattress seamed here together. There's just tiny little hints of it. It almost looks completely like the knitting is just, it goes together right there. So overall, I'm really happy. I also added little eyelash details, and I place my eyes a little differently than Rebecca does. Rebecca often places them up here. I like to place them down near the side a little bit more to have, I guess, that slightly kawaii Japanese look to things. Like, you know, when you see like all the little treats and things with little faces on them, the eyes are down low and they're off to the side and wide. But I like to do that. So as you can see, she is adorable. 17 grams of Felici is approximately 74 yards of yarn. You could very easily do these out of a leftovers from a pair of socks. They are putsy. They are a little hard to knit. I did do this on size 0 sock rockets, which is what I normally knit my socks at. So she's very nice and dense, and as you can see, like, you can't see the stuffing coming out of her. It's a very nice tight gauge. I also like this gauge, like I said, for my socks. It gives a nice firmness without being bulletproof and like standing up on its own. So yeah, and also because all the holes in here were so small, the hole at the bottom of the body was only the size of an American quarter, so it was about that big. So it made it impossible to turn her inside out and to do any three needle bind offs on the top of the head or the nose. So I ended up actually Kitchener stitching all of this shut, which the Kitchener stitch on the snout turned out pretty good, but my Kitchener stitch up top here, I could have snugged that in a little more and made that just a little bit more neat. But overall, very happy with it. And I love these colors with this hippo. It's really, really happy. It reminds me a bit of a pinata and Anna from Mochi Mochi Land. She has that huge, massive book of plus those big giant mochis. I think there's a pinata in there, and I'm thinking about doing it in fingering weight yarn and making a smaller pinata out of the same set of colorways, because I've got 3 skeins of this. Well, I guess now technically just over 2.5 skeins, but I've got 3 skeins of this yarn, and I think it would make an amazing little pinata to put in my own work area. So I think that'll be in my future. Plus, I mean, like, if you look at this with the nose and stuff, can you just picture it as like a little donkey with slightly bigger ears? And anyway, super cute. So Harriet is done. She's now going to get wrapped up and put into my daughter's stocking. We still haven't decided if we're going to have them do their presents before we leave or make them wait until we get home, because we're kind of mean that way. Now, if you guys are toy knitters and you want a suggestion for polyfill, I have a favorite brand. The only place I've been able to find this is Walmart, but my favorite polyfill to use when I make toys is Morning Glory Cluster Stuff, which, like I said, I can find this only at Walmart. These big bags are, I think, like $5. They sell some bigger ones too, but I've never found them in this particular kind. But my favorite thing about this is that unlike traditional polyfill where you have to pull it apart and fluff it, cluster fluff comes in these little pellety clouds so that you don't have to do all that. It's already kind of separated out and stuff for you. One of these bags with the type of toys that I knit, with as many toys as I have knit, I've gone through one bag and I've just started a second one. So if you're to look at my projects and see how many toys I've knit, I've gotten a lot of toys out of a single bag of these, of this. It's definitely worth the finding it and having it on hand. So once I finish those things, I continue to work on the scrap yarn blanket that I showed you last week. And last week I was in this very bottom purple section. Because this has been much easier for traveling around, taking with me, and just sometimes when I haven't had the mental space for knitting anything more complicated, I got going on this strip a little bit. So you can see I've made quite a bit of progress on this. I've added in lots of little scraps and bits. Like this strip right here is actually post sock yarn held double in that peachy stripe colorway that I can't remember what it's called that I have a pair of socks in. This blue green right here is Art Yarns Merino, I think, from one of the very first sweaters I ever knit myself back 9 years ago. This is two different colors of Knit Picks palette held together. You can see here that one's lighter and one's darker, and it makes a really beautiful kind of heathered dark gray. This was Barocco Vintage. This one right here was that other tweed I used in my daughter's blanket, which actually I accidentally brought the tag up this time, because I mentioned that with that blanket that there was one yarn that was not Barocco Vintage, and it's this one, which is SMC Northern Wool with tweeds. I don't know if this is actually made anymore, but it was color 4020, and it's made in Australia, and it's 85% wool, 10% acrylic, and 5% viscose, which I think is the tweedy bits. But I have some of that in here, and right now I'm doing Sweatshirt, which is a Brooklyn tweed shelter colorway. I originally started this blanket actually to use up this yarn that I had gone through the trouble, made a sweater out of, went to try the sweater on, and was a little unhappy with the fit, but then realized that I could still feel it poking me through my clothes. So I decided I needed something to do with the yarn because the yarn was expensive, and when I pulled it out, it's slightly felty, fuzzy looking, because this is a woolen spun yarn, so I don't think woolen spun, at least with experience with this, seems to pull out quite as nicely as plied worsted spun yarns. So I decided I need to do something with it, and I decided to put it in a blanket. You can see like right here where I switched over from the mushroom. I ran out of the mushroom and I switched over to the gray. I actually did it mid-row, which I normally don't do. Actually, that's not even the tweed there. That's actually a Knit Picks that's similar colored. Oh well. You know about that other yarn now. And I used every single little bit of it because it was just a tiny little ball. I think of like 8 or 9 grams of it. So I'm going to be taking this along with me for sure when I go to visit my grandma, because it'll be something really easy. I'm just going to take a whole bag full of scraps and I'm going to keep randomly striping it. I think I'm maybe a quarter of the way through the height of that strip. That's probably more like 20%. So I should have many hours of knitting on that. It would make excellent car knitting if I was able to knit in the car, but I'm not. So the next thing I cast on is I hinted that I was going to start casting it on. I just cast it on in the wee hours of this morning, very late hours of last night. So I'm not going to have much to show you, but I have started a sweater project that I'm doing as kind of a quick, gratifying knit. Before I pull out the other sweater I had been working on, I reclaim the yarn and I start a more complicated sweater. This is a newer pattern by Elizabeth Smith, who writes patterns under the Brown Stitch. I previously knit the Margot poncho by her and a lot of her sweaters. She has a sweater called Jessie's Girl, and then there's a Jessie's Girl cardigan. She likes to do simple knits that have just a bit of texture to them, that are maybe a little bit larger and looser. They're more layering pieces. They go great with like Sonia Phillips's like 100 acts of sewing patterns. Like, it's just kind of that same aesthetic, and it's hard not to like them. So if you like to wear like big loose dresses and you like to wear leggings, whether or not you pair them with UGG boots, goodness, that this is kind of that aesthetic. And this is the East Coast Swing. It's a new pattern. our newer pattern now. It's written for DK weight yarn, of course, because it's black and white. You're not going to see it too well, but it is a seat stitch textured A-line vest. I'm trying to see if I can find a better picture. And then the back panel is knit mostly in stockinette with sections of the garter. You can look for at the pictures on the pattern itself on Ravelry, but it has a really interesting construction, but it's knit from the bottom up. And you can see you split off for the arms, and there's a bit of a yoke detail to it and a collar. And I thought that this would be a really good use of some long languishing stash. This is Plucky Knitter Sweater. I ordered this sweater quantity. Gosh, it's been since I lived here, but I think it was 2, maybe even 3 years ago. I'll have to look at the stash page. And this is a colorway called Skies in November. Plucky Sweater is a DK weight yarn. It's a 90-10 superwash merino nylon blend. And so Plucky Knitter, Skies in November. And it's probably not going to show up right on camera because blue-greens never do. But it is a very dark... looks like it has a slight black over dye. Actually, that's not terrible. It's a really dark blue green. It's just slightly more blue on camera than it is in real life. It's a little bit more green than this, but it's a very dark, almost mallard kind of a blue, maybe just a little bit more green. Anyway, I started last night. I got it cast on and I knit 2 rows, so it's not going to look like anything. This is my amazing sweater so far, you guys. But because it's knit from the bottom up and it's meant to have a lot of room, it has a lot of stitches. It's massive. And luckily, most of the knitting, once I get past the band at the bottom, is not going to be seed stitch. I know some knitters really don't like to do knit purl texture patterns. For me, because of how I knit, it's not a problem. So yeah, you've just seen the very beginnings of this textured pattern I'm working on. I'm hoping to maybe get through the bottom band tonight so that I can switch over to the slightly faster knitting for when we are home, so that I'm doing just the side panels. I have a feeling this sweater's probably going to take me longer than till the end of the month, although part of me wants to think that I'm going to be able to finish it in that time. We'll see. I'm also going to be casting on my husband's socks very shortly here, and I'm going to work on those when we're home. I foresee myself sitting around a lot, talking to my mother or my grandmother or hopefully my sister. I'm hoping my sister will be available more when we're home, and just chatting and catching up and just working on kind of comfort, mindless knitting. So this project is going to be my mindful knitting, where I have to pay a little bit of attention to what I'm doing, but hopefully not too much. So guys, that is all of the knitting content. I have just a couple other things to show you real quick, and then I'm going to let you go. So I've had 2 things come in this week, or in the last 10 days, that would be interesting to you guys. The first is the newest issue of Ply has hit, and it is... No, this is the wrong issue of Ply. I just realized that that's the wrong issue to apply. You guys, that's the autumn issue that was also on my desk. The winter issue has just hit, which I do not have up here to show you, but it is the plying issue of Ply. Can't believe that. Anyway, I haven't had a chance to really closely look at it yet anyway to tell you anything about it, but I was just going to show you and say, hey, it's hit the newsstands. It's available now. For those of you who are interested in spinning, I have a confession to make. I have not actually read through in the entirety any of my issues apply yet, and I think one of my goals for 2017 is going to be trying to make it through an issue a month, because I think with it started in, what was it, 2013 or 2014, there's enough issues that if I do one a month, I should be able to be mostly caught up by the end of this year. We shall see. And then the other thing that came in was from Super Super Miniatures. I have 2 orders coming in from them, or from her. And I've got Christmas stitch markers coming in. This one has not come out of the plastic yet. So we're going to take just a second here and open this up. But I bought 2 separate Christmas stitch markers as they were available. The first is a pink snowflake sugar cookie with a rose gold clasp. I wanted to try and see what these were like. And I kind of like them, I think. I don't know if they're worth, if they're available for certain things, I think they're worth it. They don't cost any more than the silver ones, but you can see the details on the cookie. It's just really sweet. The other cookie was a blue one, And I think it was also a snowflake. But I think all the details on these are just so sweet. It's glittery. And I'm going to be sticking that on my sweater to mark which side is the front. And I have another one coming in, which is actually one of the gingerbread houses. It took me 3 updates to finally catch the gingerbread house, but I finally got one. And I think it's actually in the mail and on its way already. So I will have that to show you guys the next time I do a full recording. So, oh, you know what? Do you guys want to see something for Lammy? I'll show you that after, because I have a bunch of new fingering weight yarn in the shop, and Lammy's going to be open for a couple more days. So if you watch this right away, you might get in there before I close down Tuesday evening. So anyway, let's show you the yarn real quick. So in Lammy, I actually finally got my winter colorways done. I'm really late on those, guys. I did 2 new ones this year, and I'm going to be finishing up winter right after I get back. I'm going to try to dye up just a little bit of Hudson, which I haven't done yet, and then I'm going to go into the February and March winter colorways, which for me, that is still winter. It's not really spring yet. So you're going to be seeing Changeling's going to be coming up, Party Pony, Kitten's Choice, Macarons is coming back, a lot of Heartbreaker. Some of my more popular colorways are my late winter, early spring colorways, and I'm going to be trying to dye up a bunch of those. So if you have been waiting for those are coming. I'm hoping to have them out in the next 2 to 4 weeks. But for winter, I developed 2 new colorways this year. So one is Favorite Cookies, which is golden brown, and then it's about a half and half colorway. I'm not 100% sure how it's going to knit up yet. It might subtly stripe, or it's going to pool. And then it's got a vanilla area, which is frosting with pink, red, blue, and green sprinkles. So it's going to be really fun, you guys. It's going to have, there's just lots of little colors in there. It's a really fun colorway. And then the other one that's related to that is Holly Jolly, which is a cream base with more of the red, green, blue, and pink speckles, and it looks a lot like those candy canes and striped candies. And again, there's lots of colors hiding in here, you guys. They're hard to show. Especially in this light, in this camera. But anyway, you'll get lots of white with little speckles of these different colors. It's especially hard to differentiate between the pink and the red on camera, but there's a very bright pink versus a kind of a cherry fire engine red in there. And then I have a nice little batch of, and then Holly Jolly is also available on sport weight, because I did a sport weight batch earlier when I was testing it out. And then I have a small batch of a lighter variant this year of Winter J, where, I haven't cut all the ties out of these and made these super pretty yet because I got to get them into stock, where Winter J is cream with icy blue, a little bit of sandy taupe, and then some silver speckles, darker blue speckles, and peach speckles. So I have several more skeins of this too. In the past, sometimes I've gotten a little over happy with the silver and the dark blue speckles. This year I kept it really nice and light, and it's more of how I always envisioned it being. One of the dangers of small hand dyers is that we are wont to change our minds, and every batch can be very unique and maybe not look quite like what the colorway looked before. So unfortunately, you're at the mercy of our whims and how steady our hand was while working when colors come out. Most of my colors are pretty consistent, but some of them can be very different year to year. I didn't get around to any new festive conifer this year, you guys. If you have a burning desire for it, I can try to dye some up, but I'm not going to if there isn't definite interest in it. Like I said, I think I'm going to move on to the holiday colorways, or the late winter, early spring holiday colorways. So guys, the only other thing to mention is that I'm going to record once more before the end of the year, but it's not going to be a proper podcast episode. It's going to be a 0.5 like I did last year. I'm going to do an end of the year roundup and talk about my goals for 2017. I should be back with a regular podcast. I'm hoping the first Wednesday in January, which I think is the 4th. That's going to be the goal. I'm going to try to do the prize draw for Fall Into Shawls. So if you need to get your finished objects in, please get that done. I will be closing that thread on the morning of January 1st to give you the full amount of time you need on the 31st to get things turned in. And yeah, I think that's going to be it, guys. I will talk to you in, another week and a half, 2 weeks. Bye, kittens.
I want a hippopotamus for Christmas. Only a hippopotamus.